What is up, guys? It's your boy Aniki here. Today, we're going over chapter 250 of My Hero Academia. You guys already know what it is. We do this every week, every time there's a chapter out, minus the times when I'm really busy and mess up my obligations. Anyway, so a couple of things already from this chapter. The beginning actually is both surprising and yet expected. The main takeaway that I've gotten from this Toya stuff is that I think there's a chance that we already know what happened to Toya and why they all think he's dead. And I think that's something that was hinted at possibly in My Villain Academia. And in general, we have like the stage set for a pretty intense scenario. But starting from the beginning, we immediately have the opening up with the criminal who we later find out will be named Ending. And he's speaking about how he was obsessed with Endeavor. The reason why I say that this is both surprising yet unexpected, and that we didn't expect, you know, for this chapter to segue into a villain introduction and for there to be necessarily some, you know, major Endeavor fanatic, but it is not surprising in the sense that if All Might has these fans, it only makes sense that a person like Endeavor, who's in his 40s or 50s, keep in mind he reached the number two spot when he was about 20. So Endeavor's been like the second best hero in Japan since he's been for 20 years, essentially. The guy spent 20 years being just as, like, not as famous or like as revered, but ultimately in just as high a spot or as no, like in high profile position for years. So it's been decades of Endeavor. He has to have a couple of fans that are a little nutty. So the idea that we finally get one that's out here trying to kill him is kind of just an expectation. You hear about it all the time. Celebrities end up with stalkers. This is just MHA replicating, reflecting the real world more and bringing in some of that celebrity realism, you know, the kind of things they have to deal with. And our world, you know, just enhancing what's going on here. But we transition back into what's going on in the house. It's Bakugo. We see Bakugo reflecting on the face that Natsu was making and how he actually looked really upset. And he was kind of curious about that. And we find out that from Toya's perspective, that Endeavor from Natsu's perspective, Endeavor killed Toya. But based on the implications, it does seem to be like more than likely a quirk backfiring. I wouldn't be surprised if it was him trying to replicate like the prominence burn. And especially if Toya's Dabi, then if you look at him being burned in so many spots and having so many splotches even on his chest, it would make sense that he might have accidentally seared off a lot of his skin in like certain places, and he kind of got lucky. But at the same time, you gotta think he is missing the skin on his neck. Like, it's not like he didn't take damage, and his eyelids are damaged, etc. So taking that critical amount of damage would have led to some massive hospitalization. Now here's the thing, the fact that it was a quirk-based whiplash means that they might have gone to a doctor who specialized in quirks. One of the most famous doctors who specializes in quirks is Ujigo, or Dr. Tsubasa, as I'm positive his real identity will be revealed to be. And the reason, the way this works out is, back in My Villain Academia, Ujigo specifically states, yes, this is our first time meeting, though in the past we may have encountered each other before. The implication of this being that because of the fact that he runs so many hospitals, orphanages, and is involved with like daycares and does all this quirk research, the reality is that he could have brushed up with any of the League of Villains at any time prior to the story without anyone being the wiser, including himself, thinking about it in a long-term sense, because he's probably met and seen thousands upon thousands of people. Now, the thing about that's significant about this is that Ujigo could have taken Dabi, who had taken too much damage, and put him in one of his orphanages to be raised, and then potentially decided against turning him into a Nomu. If you remember, he specifically stated that, you know, we had a Nomu that was, you know, catered towards their sensibilities, and it seemed to be able to keep up with firepower on par with Endeavor's, which means that more than likely at some point you could argue that maybe Dabi, even if he doesn't know it, like having like might have had his genetic information stolen, and maybe like a Nomu had some like flame, you know, quirk thing going on with it, where potentially they managed to replicate it and saw that it did too much damage to the Nomu because of the higher heat, but that's what gave them the knowledge to think that that would be able to take on something like Endeavor. Just the potential that Dabi ended up inside of an orphanage of Ujiko's, and that would explain why they think he's dead. If he was like lied and said he was on the operating table, that he died, and then they go on grieving. Dabi goes on about his life, completely raised, separate of them now. Whether he has memories of them or not doesn't matter. I think if at that condition that he would have been in physically, he probably would have been more than happy with sacrificing his family just to get away from Endeavor and having to risk ever dealing with that kind of pain again. So we get Fuyumi showing appreciation for Deku's friendship, as well as Bakugo showing appreciation for that Mapo Tofu. It's important to remember that it is stated repeatedly that Bakugo is a fan of spicy food, so that's more than likely the reason why Horikoshi is making a point to drive that Mapo Tofu love home. Plus, it's just a way to keep Bakugo engaged as a character while relegating him to the comedy role, but still keeping him consistent within who he is. Endeavor talks about pulling them more for work. We find out that Kirishima and Uraraka are already actually doing extra days of work studies, which lets us know that they're getting more and more progress. This also kind of explains why, or you could look at it as like that kind of stuff is what has led to Uraraka being, you know, like a power, a B in power, even though she doesn't have a quirk that's like offense oriented, which is actually pretty good considering Deku and them are around A, if I remember correctly. Or I know for sure that Deku is at like A plus and Bakugo's at A and Shoto's at S. But the point is, that's actually really good for a power score. Anyway, and we also get, see, this is another reason why I say you gotta read Viz, because in the Scanlations, Deku asked Shoto for help with English, but here in the English official translation, Deku was offering to help him out. That's the minor detail, yes, but it does technically inform like who's like knowing what and what their actual strengths are as characters. And at any point, something small like this can come into play. We don't know what if Horikoshi would do that way, but like if maybe if we get an international arc and then everybody has to rely on Deku or something like that for the way he speaks English, that could just be something that we would say was foreshadowed here. Just an example. Also, it would justify if we have an international arc, them actually being able to communicate, because not everybody speaks Japanese, and My Hero Academia has been pretty consistent with showing that Americans do speak English, and they a lot of them don't necessarily have that skill, or aren't as good with it, with Pony Sunatori, so that could easily just be what that a whole plot line is like a setup for, a way for them to get to America. So, think about that. Pony could be the ace in the hole for why they end up in America when all this goes wrong, because she has family there. Obviously, if she's going to the best school in Japan while being a foreign exchange student, her family probably has a good amount of money. So, yeah, Pony might be the key to getting them into America once the war happens and society starts crumbling and they need to escape. You guys keep saying, man, that joint training arc. Also, something to note. Originally, I thought that Ending was using bandages, but if you expect, it becomes even easier to tell. He's literally ripping the paint off the sidewalk and using that as like his weapon, which I don't know. Like I think it's fascinating that he's using like the paint, the side, like the street markings and stuff. But it's kind of crazy to think that's literally like just what his power would be, the ability to manipulate road paint. People get interesting quirks in the series. I mean, he's a threat with it. He's got Natsuo completely tied up, holding him hostage, ready to kill him. And I think we finally have an interesting dynamic here where also in the, this is another thing, in the translations we had, it seemed like there was room for potentially Bakugo not being in the car because he goes, hey, get it back in the car, da-da-da. But, and here he just says, hang on, like, you know, telling them to make sure, I'm gonna hear, yep, boss, he says, hold tight, slacker, so that lets us know that they're all in the car, Bakugo is not just out, you know, hanging out with his head out while making fun of his car again, so the driver does hit the swerve, the kids are in the car right now, it's more than likely sealed up. Even though I won't promise you that they can't get out. I just don't know if Endeavor will be okay with probably Bakugo exploding the door off his car so he can go fight. I just don't know if that's something Endeavor's going to be cool with or not. That being said, we get another one of these Superman panels, essentially, is like I like to call them. Horikoshi's been really fond of using these with Endeavor with his flash fire fist when he broke out of the glass and coming out of the car, the transformations. He's doing a very good job of blending his Western comics love with these hero action poses. Huge fan of these designs. Also the fact that, you know, the guy who solved the most cases actually can remember the fact that this crazy delinquent dude that was obsessed with him was a case that he handled 7 years ago was pretty impressive. I don't know if that means that ending just sticks out more than a lot of criminals, or if it's more over just the fact that, in general, this is a weirdo who's trying to be killed by Endeavor. One of the things I saw Oceanus talk about on Twitter regarding this is how no matter what happens, it's a good setup for, you know, lambasting the hero, saying that they're not as good or stuff. But while I do agree that that can be the result and where Horikoshi can go with it if he chooses to, I think it's imperative to note that he doesn't have to go that way, especially due to the fact that people are already saying they want more lax rules. So what this could really lead to, which I think is where we're going to end up going, is even if he kills this guy, society will start backing him up, enabling the government to have more lethal force, which means that the heroes within the Paranormal Liberation Army that are within, you know, the hero society can start using that force and that excessive power to start taking down some of their rivals before the war starts, allowing them, you know, with the use of their power, to slowly cause more damage to constituents or politicians that might not necessarily have taken their side, but by increasing the collateral damage will make them more in line with the Paranormal Liberation Front's ideals, just to try to minimize the amount of damage, or something like that. So we have certain angles being set up here where we can spin this into the Paranormal Liberation Front getting their goals without the heroes getting slandered. In fact, by them placing their faith in the heroes, they are still inadvertently placing their faith in the Paranormal Liberation Front. And I think that's the angle Horikoshi is going to go with, especially if they manage to take out Endeavor before Hawks dies. Because if you have that, then what you have set up is essentially the number one hero now being the Paranormal Liberation Front's stooge, and he has to essentially somehow, at that point, convince the Paranormal Liberation Army not to just have him start espousing those ideals as the number one hero, making all of society go that way. That would actually be a very interesting position for Hawks to be in, and I could just as easily see that being where his character goes, where he either ends up dying because he won't do that, or he ends up doing that and there's no real salvation for his character as far as a lot of the fans and even what's going on within the concept of the universe can be concerned, due to the fact that he will have perpetuated the essential coup within the government of, like, to put Shigaraki, of all people, in power as far as society is concerned. So we got a lot of things being set up here. Also, Horikoshi, once again, timing it up so that when we see Trigger, because, you know, the Red Riot Unbreakable episode came out yesterday, we get the Trigger released today with, you know, Trigger was what he used to augment his razors. Ending is definitely using Trigger here. That also justifies him being able to even pose a challenge to Endeavor, because we've been having a very, you know, and Horikoshi's been making it a point to kind of show us Endeavor flexing this entire time. So, like, this gear switch of him being in a hard spot, but also given this character that's putting him in a hard spot, a steroid advantage to make sure, you know, it's further legitimized for the reader, I think is a great touch, because it doesn't, no matter what happens here, we also have the fact that steroids are, like, drugs are being in play. So there's no reason to besmirch Endeavor's name as far as the reader is concerned, even if, you know, more stuff comes to light. And then if they mention the drugs, then chances are what will end up happening also is that, well, if they're like, well, if the criminals are getting this, why can't heroes use this? And then some of the heroes who have weaker quirks, who are also within the Paranormal Liberation Front, might try to advocate for, you know, letting Trigger become more legal or accessible to heroes. Just other ways in which this particular fight can snowball into a whole host of effects, whether Endeavor loses or wins, and the impact that it can have on society. And that's what we like. This is an extremely great setup chapter. To me, this is what we read My Hero Academia for, setting up the stakes that even if it's that within the context of the small event, yeah, Endeavor needs to save Natsuo because that's his son. But like, that's a life or death scenario. That's already good enough reason, personal investment. If you're invested in the character arc of Endeavor, if you're invested in the character arc of Shoto, then you would care about how, if whether or not Natsuo dies here because of the impact that it's going to have on those two characters, or if you already care about Natsuo. So we already have a personal stakes investment. But then the fact that, in addition to that, Endeavor trying to save Natsuo here has to directly save the son that, you know, resents him the most. I personally don't think Natsuo's just going to hand him forgiveness, even if this goes well. I think it'll just be even harder and weirder, because he'll be like, yeah, I appreciate you saving me, but you did that. Whether you did that as my father or a hero, you and I will never know. And that's something that can... So there's... sorry, my nose is itchy. No Shave November, you know, the mustache pokes the nostrils. So the Natsuo plot has so many different, like, already stakes attached to it, that when we look at what this could say for the macro verse of the series and what's going on within society and the implications that it can have, it's kind of a perfectly executed scenario of getting the readers invested in the now while also being able to set up for the future. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this week's chapter. I know I did. I hope you enjoyed the new Shoto Todoroki hoodie. Thought it was time to flex, you know what I'm talking about. So yeah, if you guys like what I had to say, make sure you like. If you, you know, subscribe, if you really like this kind of analysis, I plan on doing more and more stuff as time goes on. Let me know what you guys think in the comments below, and let me know what kind of videos you're interested in seeing. I have some slated. I plan on actually doing an analysis of the Todoroki family. I was going to rush a Shigaraki video, but Todoroki's are starting to take priority due to the relevance within the series. I hope you appreciated the Samurai Jack poster that I have up there, and you guys all have a wonderful day. Anaki out.